car if you want it. Yeah, LCD. That you can pop into your radio right now when you leave. That's fine, I can make another copy. Yeah, I have it on my computer.
Good to have our resident visitors back from Colorado via Arizona, via Des Moines, Iowa. So I was thinking about what to share for tonight. Nathan and I were talking last Wednesday after the service about oneness, and so oneness is the height of maturity in the Bible, to be one with our Father and to be one with each other. And so I want to read from Ephesians chapter 4 tonight. To be mature, this is from the Message Bible. In light of all this, here's what I want you to do. While I'm locked up here, a prisoner for the master, I want you to get out there and walk, better yet, run on the road God called you to travel. I don't want any of you sitting around on your hands. I don't want anyone strolling off down some path that goes nowhere. And mark that you do this with humility and discipline, not in fits and starts, but steadily, pouring yourselves out for each other in acts of love, alert at noticing differences, and quick at mending fences. You are all called to travel on the same road and in the same direction, so stay together, both outwardly and inwardly. You have one master, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who rules over all, works through all, and is present in all. Everything you are and think and do is permeated with oneness. But this doesn't mean you should all look and speak and act the same. Out of the generosity of Christ, each of us is given his own gift. The text for this is, he climbed the high mountain. He captured the enemy and seized the booty. He handed it all out in gifts to the people. Is it not true that the one who climbed up also climbed down, down to the valley of the earth? And the one who climbed down is the one who climbed back up, up to the highest heaven. And he handed out gifts above and below. He filled heaven with his gifts, and he filled earth with his gifts. He handed out gifts of apostle, prophet, evangelist, and pastor teacher to train Christ's followers in skilled servant work, working within Christ's body, the church, until we're all moving rhythmically and easily with each other, efficient and graceful in response to God's Son, fully matured adults, fully developed within and without, fully alive. Like Christ. No prolonged infancies among us, please. We'll not tolerate babes in the woods, small children who are an easy mark for imposters. God wants us to grow up, to know the whole truth, and to tell it in love, like Christ in everything. We take our lead from Christ, who is the source of everything we do. He keeps us in every step with each other. His very breath and his very blood flows through us, nourishing us so that we will grow up healthy in God and robust in love. Mm-hmm. Now, when I read that, I think of this church. I think of this body of believers, and I am so thankful that this is a safe place where we can be led and guided by the Spirit, where we have a pastor teacher who listens to the revelation and the wisdom of God and who leads us to be more like Amen. Our God, Amen. Who gives us revelation of who our God is and who we are in him.
Yes.
And that is the source of the oneness that flows.
Yes.
And I think it's also why so many have come and so many have gone.
Yep.
There is humility required to be one with each other and
yes.
not be
yes.
the one,
yes.
but to be one.
Amen.
But there's also a strength of character, a strength and a security of knowing who you are. I just got goosebumps on my
yes.
goosebumps. It is required to know who you are,
exactly.
to know your gifts,
yes.
to walk in oneness. It requires both, and that requires maturity. And I've always wondered, why do people come and go? Well, it's one of two things. Either they couldn't be one with the one and with us. Or they didn't know who they were.
Right.
It requires both.
Yes.
And that is who God is bringing
yes.
to us. Those who hunger be one with him, to be one, to flow rhythmically. How beautiful is that?
Yeah.
One to flow rhythmically. Our God is simple. Our God is good. Our God is easy. His burden
yes.
is light.
Yes.
Yes.
It's not work. It's not difficult.
Exactly.
It is a joy.
Exactly.
It is a joy to come together, to pray for each other, to lift each other up, and to sink.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's what I think happens in this place. We sink.
Amen.
We come together as one, and when we lock arms, and when we lift our hands to God together, and when we praise him together, he comes.
Mm-hmm.
And he manifests, and he reveals himself to us in ways that are so precious.
Mm-hmm.
So precious. So I encourage you to just come. You're precious. You're part of this body, and God needs you to reveal himself
yes.
through the work in this place.
Exactly.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Yes.
Or testimonies tonight, everyone share your
word. Just prayer for my mom and my sister. They'll be traveling tomorrow just for a safe trip. And you know, that Holy Spirit accompanies them the entire trip, and when they come in here, they, you know, the blessing gets poured over them, and whatever is supposed to happen will happen. I had something else in mind, but I forgot. Oh yeah. I saw this video on Facebook, maybe this morning or last night, and it was I was really shocked because of what was on it. This guy was pretending to be a homeless man, and instead of asking people for money, he was giving them money. And, yeah, and he had a piece of cardboard that said, "You are truly rich when you give to others and are lacking nothing," something like that. And this was in LA, and it was very shocking, the reaction of people. They told him to go fly a kite. "Who do you think you are, giving me money, you piece of this and all this stuff and whatnot? I had to drive a Mercedes and I don't need you, you all this stuff and whatnot." To the point where the last guy that he did that to in the video, I thought they were gonna fight, because the guy got the guy doing the video got really mad, and he said, "You know what? I'm not even homeless," and he took his hat off and whatnot. "And I don't need this, but you, even though you say you have all this money and you have this car and you paid all this money for it, you're empty on the inside and you have no heart. Because look at how you're reacting when I just try to give you a $10 bill. Just walk away." I don't know. I think we need prayer for this nation overall, because I've never seen that before. You know, someone being so pretentious that someone else trying to do something good. And he was just doing it to prove a point. But I don't know. It's really shocking and saddening that there's people like that in this community.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I actually read in I believe it's Ecclesiastes, where he said, "You seek to work your whole life to fill your bellies, but your soul." And I am just so thankful. And I looked at you tonight and I thought, met the Lord, and I just was like, I missed Arlene. I didn't even know you were coming, so praise the Lord, God knew.
You know, you met the Lord, and you were like a sponge, and you're still a sponge, taking in all you can of Him and giving it out. God bless you.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. It's good. Yeah, Dean.
Yeah, testimony for God's goodness to me. When you're talking about being needed here, God wanted you here. I said this story several times. I was just walking down the street to go to Dolls, get on the bike, and it really felt a pull. It happened to be Sunday morning, come in here. It wasn't just, oh, church, wonder what's going on. I really felt a pull to come in here, and it's been good.
Amen. Hallelujah.
God has also got me my new place on the 15th.
Yes.
Old place is going to refund half my money.
Awesome.
We're going to paint my room, and everything's going good.
Praise the Lord.
I've been on a roll.
I know. I look forward to picking them up every week. See what's the one new blessing God has for you, Dean. Praise the Lord. God is good.
Yes, He is.
And the more we thank Him, the more blessings He has for us.
Yes.
Yeah, Mike.
Remind me again, like Pastor was talking earlier about all the kids out front and then the neighborhood and stuff like that. There's a ministry way. Just these kids are there to be brought into the kingdom. So praying for those helpers and workers, those led by the Lord to draw them in, to make a safe place for them, because this neighborhood is not a very good neighborhood, especially for children. Understanding some situations going on around here. So that Jamie and the children's ministry are led by the Lord to reach out to these little ones. There's an army out there.
Yeah.
Amen.
Said she's coming home soon.
Well, great.
So that is a complete 180.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. They walked into the court room and it was all lit up.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
They didn't think she was going to be able to come home until she was 18, and Tim posted on Facebook that she'll be home soon with them. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm hoping they can finish their adoption and, you know, make
praise
her theirs
God.
In every way.
Amen.
So that's a big praise the Lord. Yeah,
hallelujah.
I know that's a big God answers our prayers.
Yes.
It is His pleasure.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, I think, Roberto, I think that what you go through and what you share, everybody goes through, you know, and I love hearing the testimonies and knowing that we came together and
Absolutely.
We prayed for that need and God answered.
Yeah.
That is such a blessing, no matter what it is. There's nothing too small. And I love everybody. Let's stand and let's go to the Lord and let's love on Him as well. I know, I just want to give everybody a big Heavenly Father, we just thank You that You are an example of love, Lord. Oh, that You are wonderful, Lord. That You are worthy of praise, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for Your faithfulness, Lord. I thank You, Lord, that when we pray, when we come together, when we speak the needs, Lord, that You hear and You answer, Lord. That You make the way where there doesn't seem to be a way, Lord. Thank You, Lord, that there's no need too small, Lord. I thank You, Lord, as You continue to draw those to this body, Lord, knit together this body for Your glory, Lord, when we can come together in one mind and one accord to worship You, to be transformed by the wisdom and the revelation of Your word. Those seeds be planted in our hearts, Lord, and bear good fruit. Those that have been their obligations, Lord, that You be with them, that Your presence. Just a reminder, Eastern Gate House of Prayer, week from Friday, 7 p.m. Jamie will be leading the prayer ministry, and we will be worshiping the Lord.
Hallelujah.
In spirit and truth. All right, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
Lord, rejoice. And I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. John, if you want to come take the offering tonight.
Lord Jesus, we just give you the glory, Lord God. We just ask your blessing on the service, God, as we come here, Lord, to lift up you, our King and Holy God. We just want to praise you. You're so worthy and great, greatly to be praised, Lord
yes.
God. Help us to love you and
yes.
Our offerings and our thoughts and actions and everything we do. We mingle, Lord God, with people that are in the world that will just be what you want us to be, shining lights, Lord God, that you can
yes.
Lift through us and shine through us. Give the glory to you in the holy name of Jesus.
Well,
amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let us worship the Lord. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Lord of the Rings. Anyway.
Gathering together from the north.
passing by me. In order that you may know and believe and understand that I am He. He is the Lord, Jesus Messiah. There's no other Savior to call. In these troubled times, when Paul seems forsaken and we only see the fruit of the fall, shout to the nations and shout to the Lord. Lift up your voices and sing. We have the right to speak to this world. Heal up your captives today. Father is calling, give them up. All those created for the glory of God, all those who ran away, give them up.
From the east, the south and west, north, let the prisoners free. The women running from their homes and their marriages, men who will not stand and be the man of the Lord. We call you back, we call you back, we call you back in Jesus' holy name. Those who are called by the Father to lead and teach, take up your mantle that you have left behind. Go to the mountain that the Lord has called you to, the mountain of freedom and of love. Don't be caught under the law, don't be caught under the law and religiosity. So be free in the message of the grace that is behind you. Be free in the love that Jesus bore on a cross for you. He set His Spirit and His kingdom to be upon you. Now let it rise in you. Come back to the calling of the Lord. Come back to the calling of the Lord. So come back unto the calling, come back unto the calling, come back unto the calling of the Lord. Let the little children come and forth and prophesy the kingdom thing. Let them speak the heart of the Lord. Calling forth a generation, the Joshua generation, release the love of the Lord. We bind you, religious spirit, we bind you, the doctrine that holds back the kingdom of the Lord. Oh, we love you, Lord Jesus. Let your kingdom further, let your bride be ready for the bridegroom. So come.
Pour out your spirit.
Pour out your spirit. Pour
You are my witnesses.
Witnesses, declares the Lord, servants chosen by me. Knowing that you may know and believe and understand that I am He. He is the Lord, Jesus Messiah. There's no other Savior to call. In these troubled times, when all seems forsaken and we only see the fruit of the fall, shout to the nations and shout to the Lord. Lift up your voices and sing. We have a right to speak in this world. Give up your captives today. Give them up. Give them up. Give them up. Father is calling, give them up, give them up, give them up. And all those created for glory of God, and all those who ran away, give them up, give them up, give them up. Jesus is calling, give them up, give them up, give them up.
Hallelujah, Lord. Can it be that I should gain an interest in Him, the Savior's blood? Died He for me, who caused His pain, for me to Him to death pursue. Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, my God, would die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, left His Father's throne above, so fast in infinite His grace, emptied Himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy can. die for me. Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray, I woke in dungeon's flamed in life, 'cause my chains fell off, my heart was free. Lord, I rose, went forth and followed thee. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth and followed thee. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, could die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, could die for me? Oh, voices. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, would die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, would die for me? Thank you, Lord, that you are so approachable. Thank you, Lord, you are so approachable. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. with you.
Lord, we love you tonight. We Thank you, Lord, for your presence, for your grace, your mercy, for your great love wherewith you've loved us, Lord. Lord, it's hard for us to even understand and comprehend how great that love is. But you placed all the demands upon yourself and given us the free gift of eternal life, fellowship with you, oneness with your Spirit, Lord. For that we will eternally be grateful. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you tonight, Lord. You are a great and a mighty God. There is none like you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for being a good God. Thank you for loving us. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody say praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Praise God. Great to have Darlene and Don back. Amen. Looking forward. I was going to say they're old friends, but I just say they're long-time friends. Praise the Lord. We all get a little touchy at some point, you know. Praise the Lord. But amen. And we're looking forward to making new friends with Roberto's mother and sister. They come up. But looking forward to that. That's going to be a good time. Praise the Lord. So we're excited for him to have his family here. And we're excited about getting to meet them and become friends with them as well. So, but tonight, I just want to welcome Darlene and Don back. It's great to see them. They are good friends, and they've been real friends to this church, period, as well as to Sally and I personally, and we really appreciate them. Glad they made it back safe and sound, and
amen.
Look forward to seeing them over the next several weeks. Praise the Lord. All right, let's begin with a couple of scriptures. I'm going to read to you from, but first of all, I want to read Hebrews chapter 4. I'm going to read that whole chapter. It's not long. I mean, I think it's like 16 verses, but it's worth just for the context of what I want to talk to you about tonight. So Hebrews chapter 4, and we'll just go right down through, Roberto. Praise God. Church still looks good. I almost got to do some evangelizing tonight. The kids were all on the front steps. They scattered like I threw a grenade when I got out of the truck, but they left a nice note for me in chalk all over the front steps. I didn't recognize most of the words, but there was a 666 there. I'm hoping it was somebody's address, but I'm not sure. But anyway, that's the worst that they ever do. We'll be in good shape, and amen. Hopefully we can reach out to them and get some of these kids in the church instead of just on it. Praise the Lord. Okay, Hebrews chapter 4. Beginning of verse 1, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Now this is to the Roman or to the Hebrews. So these are Jews, believers and non-believers that have not necessarily all converted to Christianity, but so they're stuck in this religious thing. Even those that have come into faith in Christ are still trying to figure out how they Judaize that. And we know Paul had some issues with Peter and different situations where that was the case. But so he's trying to get them to understand this is no longer about the stuff they've been doing for the last several thousand years. It's now about coming into the rest that God has provided, coming into grace and into the mercy of Christ. It's no longer what they do, it's what Christ has done. So for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Seeing, therefore, it remaineth that some must enter therein. And they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limiteth a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day. There remaineth, therefore, a rest to the people of God. For he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Now, this puts the whole thing into context, because here he says, let us therefore. Now, the whole thing has been about entering into his rest. Mm-hmm. And then he says, to kind of encapsulate the entire chapter, he finishes up with, let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace. That's the rest. That's where the rest is. And that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Amen? All right, now let's go to James chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore, he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Now, it's almost a reflection of what he's saying back, what Paul had said in Hebrews, and that is that it's by grace that we come to God. You can't come to God any other way. The only way you can draw nigh to God is through his grace. And as you draw nigh to him, he gives you more grace, more of him. And so he says, submit yourself to God. Well, we believe that meant, you know, submit to do a bunch of stuff. No, it's submitting to his grace is all he's asking us to do. That's all we can do, is submit to that grace. And so to do that, that is how we draw nigh to God. Mm-hmm. And also how then God will draw nigh to you.
Exactly.
You can't get there any other way. There's just not any other way.
Right.
We enter into rest.
Right.
We cease from work, the same way God did at the end of his work. We cease from it. That draws us to God, and it draws God to us. Amen? So James just says it, if you'll go back to verse 6 there. He says it as plain as you can make it, but he giveth more grace. Man, talking about goosebumps. I feel it now. I've you know, preached some Holy Ghost, you know, Pentecostal stuff, but I feel more of God in that short sentence. I mean, it's the most beautiful scripture, I think, one of the most beautiful scriptures in the Bible. But he giveth more grace.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You're never going to find God's source of grace
exactly.
Lacking.
Exactly.
There'll never be not enough. It's always exceeding abundantly more. Where sin abounds, grace doth that much more abound. Praise the Lord. At your most desperate, and all of us feel this way at times, the most desperate moment when you think that you've reached the last drop of God's love, and he couldn't possibly be gracious again toward that sin. Whatever. Whatever it is. Amen?
Amen.
Sure enough, God gives more grace.
Come on.
I mean, this really is too good to be true. This is the good news. My only regret is that I didn't know it sooner.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. But it's a beautiful thing. The only way we reach anybody in this world, it's not handing them a track. It's not telling them they're going to go to hell. It's telling them how much God loves them.
Yes.
He has accepted them. All they have to do is say yes. It's that simple. That's all there is to it. It's not complicated. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. What does God give to those who have squandered grace? You know what, the way it's described in many churches is it's well, they're just taking advantage of God. Let me tell you something. You can't do it. You cannot take advantage of God, because what God does when you squander his grace is he gives you more grace.
That's right.
It's like the prodigal son. He went out and blew everything that his father gave him. He comes back and his father just unloads a whole bunch more on him. That's a perfect metaphor for God and us. You cannot squander away grace, because the more you squander it, the more he just gives it.
Exactly.
It in the natural, it doesn't make sense. It sounds like that's just so one-sided, but that is exactly what the gospel is. One-sided. God does it all.
Yes.
All we do is receive. Amen? Amen? God's grace toward us cannot be exhausted.
That's right.
Fix it in your mind. It cannot be exhausted. You can't out-sin it, praise the Lord. You can't out-mess it up. We'll never arrive at the end of God's grace. Never. Not throughout all of eternity. His grace just keeps flowing, praise the Lord. Now when, not if, we've mismanaged his grace, what does God draw us back with? More grace. I mean, it's fantastic. Praise the Lord. It's all grace, more grace. Let's look at Psalms chapter 32, verse 1. Now, if you can't get happy about this, there's something wrong. I mean, this is the joy of the Lord that gives that brings strength to him and strengthens us. Because the more he gives grace, the more grace he has to give. It's a limitless supply. Amen? It's that river flowing, you know, from inside. Praise the Lord. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered forever. Not just till the next screw up, but forever. That's a blessed person. That's us. We are blessed. We're blessed going in. We're blessed coming out. We're blessed everywhere we go, any place we go, because our transgression is forgiven. Our sins are done away with. They don't exist. It's not some magic trick or some sleight of hand. It just doesn't exist. It's gone. God, you know, God has this fantastic capacity that I think we overlook sometimes. He literally can forget what he wants to forget.
Right.
We try to, you know, suppress it or not think about it or not allow it to influence us, but he just flat out forgets it. It doesn't exist. God knows, the only thing God knows about me is Christ.
Yes.
All he knows about me is I'm perfect in Christ. I'm perfect. I can do no wrong.
Come on.
Amen.
It's not like our kids. You know, we have kids. And the first 2 years, we spend all of our time teaching them how to talk and how to walk. And the next 16, we spend all of our time telling them to sit down and shut up. Praise the Lord. Yeah, right? But God's not like that. We come and everything's perfect with God. He draws nigh to us. He wants us to draw nigh to him. Praise God. If you're not experiencing the joy, the happiness of God's forgiveness, because forgiveness and happiness go hand in hand. They're inseparable. If you really feel forgiven, you can't help but feel happy. If you know everything is good with you and God, you've got to be happy.
Right.
I mean, I don't care. I mean, it's such a liberating gospel. It's such a freeing experience. And God, whom the Son sets free, is free indeed. You don't have to sit around and check your list. Is this going to be okay? Is that going to be okay? No, just live life and enjoy life. That's what God wants for you. That's why he's given us this.
Exactly.
To experience it, to enjoy it, to love it. I love how he says, eat the fat and drink the wine. Man, that's my kind of God. I get it. To me, that's barbecue. You know, let's have a good time. Right? Every Jewish feast, it's a party. It's a celebration. Have fun, enjoy what God has provided. That's what our lives are supposed to be. And we've dumbed it down and diminished it to the point where it's just drudgery. He says that's not what it is. It's, if you're going to work at anything, work at getting rest. Work at accepting this that I have to offer you. Work at getting your mind renewed to the goodness of God and the grace of God and the love of God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, you've never read enough, you've never prayed enough, you've never obeyed enough to get God's grace.
Come on.
That's what makes it grace. You can't do enough. You can't do too little. It's just grace. Look at Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 7. And I can understand. I used to think people say, I'm falling more and more in love with God all the time. I used to think, okay, that's Joyce Meyer. I'm a guy. I just can't quite get my head around that kind of stuff. But honestly, I see now. I understand because maybe better than they. How can you not love somebody that just loves you in spite of you, that just, you know, gives you everything and all things? You're drawn to it. There's no sense of guilt or shame that you got to feel like, well, you know, I think I might have snuck one past him, you know, and so can I get closer? No, it's just he just loves you just the way you are. How can you not love that? How can you not love him back? And that's what he tells us, because he first loved us. Now, love is able to move from us, right? For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But after that, the kindness and love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared. Not by works of righteousness, which we've done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Yes. That being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Yes. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Here's why that grace won't run out. Amen? It can't run out. It comes from God, eternal. Look at Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 14. Being justified, you see? Praise God. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. That's us. By one offering, we've been perfected. You can't unperfect it. You can't diminish the perfection. You may never hear this again from anybody. You're perfect. You're perfect. You're a 10. You're like a 10,000 as far as God's concerned. I love that. I don't hear that often. I have to renew myself to that. Praise the Lord. I am perfect.
Yes. Yes.
Think about it. Perfect.
Thank you, Lord.
Perfect. I mean, we look at cars. We look at one another. We look at jewelry. Always looking for perfection. But we always find the flaws because we're looking. You know, you buy a car, you drive it home. I hate people that do that. You know, you notice that little thing there and the paint doesn't look quite like it does.
Yeah.
I hate that. You know, I mean, God doesn't do that. He sees you perfect. And he's not pretending. He literally declares you perfect.
Amen.
Man, we ought to be the happiest people in the world. We ought to be the happiest people on this planet.
Yeah.
If God is for us, and he is, then who can be against us? Who's going to do anything to mess with his elect that can really screw with us? Amen? Nobody. Bottom line, God has declared us perfect, and he will not allow anything to flaw us.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. When God gives us more grace, he gives us more of God. He gives us more of himself. That's his identity. That's his reality. That's his character. That's what he's doing. The more he gives us grace, the more of his love you experience, the more you feel that, and the more you know of God. It sounds almost counterintuitive, but the truth is, the more grace you receive, the more God you get.
Exactly.
And we've tried to make it about us seeking and searching and digging and, oh, we're going to try to get more of God. Listen, the way you get more of God, just embrace the grace of God. Just rest in what he's doing for you. And you'll just feel the power and the love of God flood over you. It's great. It's what God wants for us. Amen? If you read all of James 4, and we didn't do it tonight just for the sake of time, but it's all about Christians who are embroiled in quote-unquote worldliness. They're totally wrapped up in everything that's in the world. And here's what James says to them. these worldly Christians. He comforts them. And he says, it's okay. He gives them more grace. He gives more grace. That's his response to it. He gives more grace so he can draw nigh to you.
Yes.
All you have to do is submit to that grace, draw nigh to God, and more God keeps coming your way. Now that's how he deals with what the church would call worldly sinners, Christian sinners. He says, here's the way God deals with it. More grace. He just gives more grace. He can't help himself. He's like a grandparent spoiling the grandchild. It's okay. It's okay. Just here. The parents, we taught how to walk and talk and then told them to sit down and shut up for 16 years. The grandkids, they tell us to sit down and shut up. We go, okay. What can I get for you? You know? It's just a whole different mindset. Right? We're not trying to make them perfect. We love them just the way they are. This is God. God loves us. And he has declared us perfect just the way we are.
Yes.
This is what Suzanne was talking about, I believe. If you have an identity, if you know who you are, you can handle almost anything. I mean, if you're secure in who you are, right? And it makes other people feel secure because it's insecure people that cause other people to be insecure. Insecure people are always demanding, wanting something to, you know, reinforce their self-worth. But people that are secure, they don't need it. So it makes other people free just being around them. They feel free being around you because they're thinking, that's the way they are. I don't have to prove anything to them. That's God. That's the way God wants us to live our lives. We're attractive to people that way. People are attracted to us when we live our lives that way. That's a true witness. That is revealing the light of Christ. That's revealing the true nature of God. That's the only way we can do it. Amen? Like the prodigal son being hugged by his father. You can feel God's grace. You can feel it. You can know his kindness. You can know his goodness. I mean, know it in a tangible way. You can know his love. When you don't fear, you know?
Exactly.
Religiously, we're always saying the fear of the Lord. Oh, well, we don't mean to be afraid of God. And then we spend the next hour scaring the hell out of people so that they'll do what they want them to do.
Yeah. Right.
No, God does not want us to be afraid of him.
Right.
How could it be? God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of peace, love, joy, and a sound mind. Why is it then we go to church and half the time we leave or have afraid?
Right.
Something other than God's going on there, because God doesn't give you that spirit.
Right.
Anytime you're afraid, you can mark it down. It's not coming from God. It's not God. Praise the Lord. Now, David got it. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven. And we, you know, point out David because he had the big A, you know. Listen, that was just one of many. It wasn't, you know, like the big one. It was just one of multitudes, right? And he was a man after God's heart. God said that about him. David didn't say it about himself. God said it about him. Why? Because David embraced the forgiveness and the grace of God. Man. You want to be a friend of God?
Yeah.
Not just a son or a daughter, but a buddy, a friend? That sounds like blasphemy almost. But that's what God wants.
Yeah.
And the only way you can have it is by accepting his grace.
Mm-hmm.
So that he can give you more grace.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Blessed is the man. It's not depressed is the man. Right? It's not gloomy is the man, but happy is the man whose transgressions are forgiven. Hallelujah. Praise God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 7. Now, this always kind of intrigues me because, you know, the Bible talks about the mysteries of the Scripture and so forth. So the Gospels, it's simple and yet complex. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. Now, this is Paul's talking to these Corinthians who were, I mean, these were crazy people, got drunk in church, were still going to temple prostitutes. Christians, these were Christians. And they were just really all over the place, right? But Paul said, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. Now, that word glory, it always refers, we think of it as being, you know, like the Shekinah glory. But what it means is manifestation. It just means the manifestation of God. So he says, even a hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. So God is manifest to us and in us.
Yes.
And he does it by grace.
Yes.
Amen. It's another way of saying, as we receive grace, he giveth more grace.
Yes.
We draw nigh to him, he draw nigh to us. Mm-hmm. Right? So the gospel, it's elementary and it's advanced. The gospel is for new Christians and it's for old Christians.
Yep.
No matter how long you've been a Christian, this is the news you need to be hearing.
Right.
Praise the Lord. We all need the same thing.
Yes.
We all need, I like the Toronto church, they're always talking about soaking. They're having these soaking events.
Uh-huh.
I guess that's cool. Praise the Lord. But we all need a good soak in the grace of God. We need to be saturated with it. We need to have it just, you know, running off of us. Amen? So I agree. We need a good soaking. But we need a soaking in the grace of God. In Jesus, there is a fountain. You want to get soaked? Praise the Lord. In Jesus, there is a fountain deep and wide, it says. Praise the Lord. I like that. Amen. I wonder if that isn't the river that he's urging us to wade in. Get it up to your waist, up to your chest. Then water that you can't walk in. You can't even swim in it. You just get caught up and carried away by it. Hallelujah. I think that's the waters he's wanting us to enter into. That's the deep and wide, amen, fountain of Jesus. Praise the Lord. It's time for us to go deep. It's time for us to go deep into the gospel. Praise the Lord. Amen. And going deep doesn't mean studying the end times,
right,
or the original biblical languages.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with that, but that's not what going deep is about. It's not about reading up on the four keys to this or that.
Right.
Going deep means plunging into the grace of God.
Come on.
You cannot get too much of it. Praise the Lord. Colossians chapter 2, verse 3. In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. We just sang about that a moment ago, but in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Now we know that grace is a person. Grace is Jesus. Amen? And it doesn't get any deeper than Jesus.
That's right.
Praise the Lord. All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are in him. And he is grace. So how about, the more grace we get, the more wisdom we have, the more knowledge we'll have, the more revelation we'll have, because it comes to us truly by the Spirit of God. It can't come any other way, because you can't do anything to get it. It's walking by the Spirit. It's being led by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It is the Spirit. We've been sealed with His Holy Spirit. We've been sealed with grace. Man. You know, we just sealed our deck. Praise the Lord. And the water just bubbled off of it this morning. I mean, it was like I just spent $500 on a wax job for the car. I mean, it's sealed. The good news about us is, unlike that deck, you can't wear the seal off. It just stays, and everything just flows off of you. Amen? If you're in Christ, you're okay. Hallelujah? Amen. Can't get any deeper than Jesus. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. And to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God.
Yes.
That's what we need to know more about. That's what we need to know more than anything else. You want to go deep? Praise the Lord. Focus on the gospel. Recover the gospel. Have a personal reformation. Praise the Lord. Dig deep enough into the gospel and you'll start to think right about the end times. It won't be fearful anymore. It won't be the scary stuff that we see often or that we hear often. But you'll really begin to have some revelation about the end time and realize that Jesus is coming back for his church. Amen?
Amen.
The people that he bought with his life. That's all it amounts to. That's all it is. That's all we got. All we got is something to look forward to, not something to fear and dread and be intimidated by and anxious. Amen?
Amen.
He's coming. When he comes, we'll know it because he's coming for us.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
When I was a kid dating, it was always thought to be kind of unpopular for sure, but kind of crude, I guess, to pull up to pick up your date and just honk the horn. Now I think it's probably just the way it's done. But then you had to get out, you had to go to the house, and for God forbid you might have to meet the father, the mother, the brothers, whoever else, and just get it over with and get the girl back to the car, you know. I like the way Jesus does it. He's just coming close enough, and he's going to honk the horn. Praise the Lord. It says there's going to be a shout, a trumpet will sound, a shout, and we're out of here. Amen. We're just gone. Praise the Lord. I like it. I like it just fine. I think he's coming. I hear the horn, and I'm ready. Praise the Lord. We're out of here. So, amen. Jesus is coming back for the church.
Yes, he is.
The end times are really just all about the Alpha and the Omega.
Yes.
The beginning and the end.
Yes.
The I Am.
Yes.
The Jesus. The grace. Amen?
Amen.
Another scripture, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, the Alpha the Omega, author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Praise God.
Amen.
Or how about we go deep, or as Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18 says it. Ephesians 3:18. Is that 3:18?
Yeah.
Hmm?
You gave me 19 before.
Oh, I'm sorry. I want 18.
That is 18.
Not 3:18.
That's not 3:18. I want the deep and wide.
I chose the wrong book.
That's okay. They're all good. I may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. So that's going deep. Grace is deep. It's bottomless. It's endless. So let me just close like this. He gives more grace.
Yes.
It's endless. It's bottomless. Praise the Lord. More grace. That's your God.
Amen.
And he's a good God. He's good all the time.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And nothing is impossible with him, not even us. Give him a hand clap tonight. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Just remember, he giveth more grace. You're dismissed. In Jesus' name. There we go. Don't worry. Be happy.